إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه فمنهم من قضى نحبه ومنهم من ينتظر وما بدلوا تبديلا وقال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم إن الله يتجلى للناس عامة ويتجلى لأبي بكر خاصة أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام صدق الله مولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين Honorable ulama ikram, respected brothers, elders, mothers and sisters, when we refer to Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhu, reference is made to them by using the honorable title of Shaykhain. I don't think it would be incorrect for me to use the term Shaykhain with regards to the honorable speakers that have spoken before me. And just as the Sahaba used to say, in the presence of Shaykhain, nobody else can speak. We have amongst us the two respected honorable scholars and contemporaries of our time. May Allah give them barakat in their health and their wealth. Undoubtedly the Shaykhain of our time, may Allah take them from strength to strength. Let me then say, وَغَيْرُ تَقِيٍّ يَأْمُرُ النَّاسَ بِالتَّقِيِّ طَبِيبٌ يُدَاوِي وَالطَّبِيبُ عَلِيلُ That it is in essence a person who lacks piety is advocating piety. It is like a doctor who is treating a patient yet he himself is sick. وَغَيْرُ تَقِيٍّ يَأْمُرُ النَّاسَ بِالتَّقِيِّ طَبِيبٌ يُدَاوِي وَالطَّبِيبُ عَلِيلُ With regards to the Sahaba Ikram, Allah makes a clear distinction in the Quran. لَا يَسْتَوِي مِنْكُمْ مَنْ أَنْفَقَ مِنْ قَبْلِ الْفَتْحِ وَقَاتَلْ أُولَٰئِكَ أَعْظَمُ دَرَجَةً مِنَ الَّذِينَ أَنْفَقُوا مِنْ بَعْدُ وَقَاتَلُوا وَكُلًّا وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْحُسْنَى وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ That those Sahaba who responded to the call in the early hours and those who responded after the conquest of Mecca, perhaps they are par in enjoying the privilege of being referred to the companions of Nabi alayhi salam. However, those who responded in the early hours, the merit, the virtue, the privilege they enjoy, like the poet said it so beautifully, Inni uhibbu aba hafsin wa shi'atihi, kama uhibbu atiqan sahib al-ghari. Wa qad radhitu aliyan qudwatan, wa ma radhitu bi qatli al-shaykh fi al-dari. كل الصحابة ساداتي ومعتقدي فهل علي بهذا القول من عاري I wish you could comprehend this in Arabic. The poet says, إني أحب أبا حفص وشيعته. I love very passionately Sayyidina Umar and his family. كما أحب عتيقا صاحب الغاري. Just as I hold in great merit the noble companion Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه. وقد رضيت عليا قدوة. And I am more than happy in accepting Sayyidina Ali as my leader. وَمَا رَضِيتُ بِقَتْلِ الشَّيْخِ فِي الدَّارِ And I will never condone the brutal murder of the innocent Khalifa Uthman ibn Affan. In essence, let me conclude my couplets by saying, كُلُّ السَّحَابَةِ سَادَاتِ All Sahabas, the entire galaxy of Sahaba, are my guiding stars. فَهَلْ عَلَيَّ بِهَذَا الْقَوْلِ مِنْ عَارِ Is there anyone to comment on what I have said? When we look at the verses of the Quran, Allah speaks in the 17th juz in Surah Al-Hajj, الَّذِينَ إِمَّكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ الَّذِينَ إِمَّكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهَوْا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَلِلَّهِ عَاقِبَةُ الْأُمُورِ Allah speaks about this. This verse was revealed after the Sahaba made hijrah to Medina Munawwara. But Allah painted a picture that was to prevail in the latter part of Islam, And what did Allah say in this verse? Alladhina dhaw sahaba immakkannahum fil ard. If we ever have to give them authority on this land, by virtue of authority and position, what would they establish? Aqam as-salah. They would establish salah. And they will discharge zakah. They will invite towards good and they will forbid from evil. In other words, Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu in Ruhul Ma'ani, it is written, he used to say, Thana'un qabla bala'in. Allah has praised those that will deserve this honor way before Allah engaged them. And of course, we all unanimously agree that this error became a reality and was transmitted and manifested during the Khulafa'i Rashideen al-Mahdiyyin. Just to single out the life of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu very briefly, I will speak about basically running through few Sahaba, highlighting some virtues and then some point of reference through which we can deduce some lesson. Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu took the reins of the Islamic Empire at perhaps the most critical and crucial juncture in the annals of Islamic history. At a time when we know Sayyidina Safiya radiallahu anha said it so beautifully on the demise of Nabi alayhi salam. She said, Wallahi ma abki an-nabiyya limawtihi walakin liharajin ba'daka atiya. Wallahi ma abki an-nabiyya limawtihi walakin liharajin ba'daka atiya. Falaw anna rabbal arsh abqaka baynana sa'idna walakin amruhu kana madhiya. She said, I am not lamenting only the death of Nabi alayhi salam, but rather what I am lamenting that his death orphans the entire ummah. The challenge and the catastrophe that stares at the ummah. فَلَوْ أَنَّ رَبَّ الْعَرْشِ أَبْقَاكَ بَيْنَنَا سَعِدْنَا. If Allah only prolonged your stay amongst us a bit longer, it would be our privilege. But then the reality had to prevail. The time was decreed and ordained. وَلَكِنْ أَمْرُهُ كَانَ مَاضِيًا. Like the couplets come to mind with regards to consoling someone. They say, إِنِّي مُعَزِّيكَ. لا أني على ثقة من الخلود ولكن سنة الدين فما المعزى بباق بعد ميته ولا المعزي ولو عاش إلى حين وما الدهر إلا هكذا رزية مال أو فراق حبيبي. Oh my brother, I'm consoling you not because I'm going to love on, but because it is the noble teachings of Nabi alayhi salam. Neither me nor you will see eternity. What can I say? This in essence is the nature and the pattern of life. Sometimes it's a beloved, sometimes it's a belonging. We have to separate from both. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu came at this critical juncture and rescued the ummah and consolidated this ummah. In the words of my mother Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, لَقَدْ نَزَلَ بِأَبِي مَا لَوْ نَزَلَ بِالْجِبَالِ الرَّاسِيَاتِ لَهَا ظَهَا. On the death of Nabi alayhi salam, the challenge that rested on my father was so colossal, was so mammoth, was so weighty. Wallahi, if it came on the mountains of this world, even the mountains would have shattered into pieces. The vision of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, the maturity of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, that he sits with Nabi alayhi salam, there is a symptom of recovery in the last moments. He takes consent to go and visit his other wife who's on the outskirts of Medina. When he barely gets there, the news is broken to him that the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has passed away. None can appreciate the pain that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu went through for the simple reason that none had that closeness with Nabi alayhi salam like Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Yet he comes there composed, totally composed, calm. Can we imagine the sentiments, the pain, the agony? Words cannot really do justice to translate the emotions of any sahabi, never mind Abu Bakr at this juncture. He comes to Nabi alayhi salam, lifts the blessed cloth, kisses his blessed head. طِبْتَ حَيًّا وَمَيِّتَا. O Nabi of Allah, you were unique when you were alive and you're equally unique now that you're gone. مَوْتُ التَّقِيِّ حَيَاتٌ لَا نَفَادَ لَهَا قَدْ مَاتَ قَوْمٌ وَهُمْ فِي النَّاسِ أَحْيَاءُ. The poet says the death of a Nabi is actually life. Many people have physically died, but yet they live in our thoughts and our minds. قَدْ مَاتَ قَوْمٌ وَهُمْ فِي النَّاسِ أَحْيَاءُ. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's time in essence was very short, very 2 years barely. But at this critical juncture, the manner in which he consolidated the ummah, how he united the ummah, and he entrusted a united ummah. Brothers, as a father, you find bickering in your children. As a principal, you find bickering in your staff. As an employer, you find bickering in your employees. We know what a daunting task it is when everyone has a passion towards you. You've got to accommodate the sentiments of every person, and the ultimate is that peace must reign amongst those people. At a juncture when the forces of evil were thriving, when they were exploiting, when so many evils had crept in, Abu Bakr sharing the greatest grief. But what vision, what integrity, what wisdom that till today we enjoy this unity because of the contribution of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. In the throes of death, he calls Umar ibn Khattab, and subhanallah, he says, Inni istakhlaftu ba'di Umar ibn al-Khattab, fa'in adala fa'dhalika dhanni fi, wa'in jara wa baddala fa'l-khayra aradtu. Subhanallah, he calls Umar ibn Khattab, he says, I now hand over to you, O Umar. If you will exercise justice, then that is my expectations from you. However, if you fall short, then Allah knows my intentions were noble. Allah knows my, and this was the beauty of Sahaba. أَقَلُّهُمْ تَكَلُّفًا. There was nothing like formality in their life. There was nothing like formality. Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu anhu goes with his brother to propose. Now we go and propose, we know how fancy we go. And then if the opposite party doesn't comply to our standards, we feel offended. Look at how many we went, see how few they were to receive us. Look at our kunchas, look at how they received us. We get offended. You listen to a CV like this, I doubt you've ever heard it. They said, listen, أنا بلال وهذا أخي. Allahu Akbar. أنا بلال وهذا أخي. He goes to propose to his future father-in-law. عبدان من الحبشة. كنا ضالين فهدان الله. وكنا عبدين فأعتقنا الله. إن تنكحونا فالحمد لله وإن تمنعونا فالله أكبر. This riwayat comes in Hayatul Sahaba. أنا بلال وهذا أخي. I am Bilal and this is my brother. عبداني من الحبشة. Nothing fancy, two Abyssinian slaves. We were astray, Allah guided us. We were slaves, Allah liberated us. If you give me the daughter of your hand, Alhamdulillah. If you decline, Allah is sufficient. وإن تمنعونا فالله أكبر. With the grace of Allah, I had the privilege of traveling with Hazrat Mawlana Shabir Sahib in the Middle East, and Alhamdulillah, we went to the grave of Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu anhu. Brothers, wallah, you will only cry and sob like a baby. Thousands of miles away from Medina Munawwara, Babu Sagheer, we entered into this maqbara in the presence of Mawlana. I had the opportunity of traveling with Mawlana. When we look at two muazzins of this ummah lying in this graveyard, Abdullah ibn Maktoum and Bilal radiallahu anhu, one has no choice but to be moved into sentiments. So Sahaba had no takalluf. You take the famous hadith that comes in Bukhari, comes in Abu Dawud, on the occasion of the conquest of Makkah, when Nabi alayhi salam had made his strategy and his intelligence, and he had an army of 10,000 Sahaba to invade Makkah, and everything was discreet. And a Sahabi by the name of Hatib ibn Abi Balta was overpowered by emotions. And he made some in arrangements to go and divulge the secret of Nabi alayhi salam, to inform his family members so that they could protect themselves and take adequate measures against the potential invasion. Nabi alayhi salam was informed via revelation. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam called Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a radiallahu anhu. Now a mistake that he had committed, but look at how clean they were. He said, Ya Rasulallah, listen to me, O Nabi of Allah. Ma kafartu wal artadattu. Let me start off by saying, Allah be my witness, I haven't forsaken you nor abandoned you. Neither kufr nor renegade has entered in me. My plans to divulge your secrets were not because I have opposed you. I have no inner threat to you. Let me open up the reality to you. I was overpowered by sentiments. The other Sahaba have relatives in Makkah. I had absolutely no relatives. I could not see planning taking place here to invade Makkah, knowing very well that that planning will go against my relatives. And hence I have done what I have done. I beg of your forgiveness. Nabi alayhi salam said, Amma hadha faqad sadaq. This man has spoken the truth. I have pardoned him. Nobody harassed him. So Sahaba had absolutely no takalluf. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu takes the reins of the Islamic empire. Prior to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu making Umar in charge, he asked the Sahaba, I want to make Umar in charge. What's your people's opinion? They all said, we are happy with him. Only one thing, he's very stern. He's very harsh. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, I swear by Allah, the burden of Khilafat will soften him. The burden of Khilafat will soften him. Someone came to Abu Bakr, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, and he said, Anta khayrun min Abi Bakr. Abu Umar, now this is the point. You know, I'm looking at my time. But anyway, inshallah, I will try and condense myself. I thought I'd share one quality in the life of every Sahabi. One quality of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu with reference to the riwayat of Bukhari Sharif. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's profound love for Quran. وكان أبو بكر رجلا بكاء لا يملك عينيه إذا قرأ القرآن. Abu Bakr, when he read Quran, he cried profusely. Brothers, Allah give us true love for Quran. When Abu Bakr was leaving and Ibn Daghina met him on the outskirts of Makkah and he said, come back, I give you shelter and I give you amnesty. And then he gathers the people of Makkah and he said, if Abu Bakr leaves here, you know how society will shun you. And then he told Abu Bakr, I give you amnesty and I give you protection. So the kuffar told Abu Bakr, they told Ibn Daghina, we don't have any problem with Abu Bakr. Only one thing, he reads Quran so beautiful that our woman cannot resist his recitation. فَإِنَّا نَخْشَىٰ أَن يَفْتِنَ نِسَاءَنَا وَأَبَنَاءَنَا مُرْ أَبَا بَكْرٍ فَلْيَعْبُدْ رَبَّهُ فِي دَارِهِ. Tell Abu Bakr to worship Allah secretly. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu agreed. ثُمَّ بَدَى لِأَبِي بَكْرٍ. But we see our young boys, Allah give hidayah to one and all, who are listening to music, who are listening to batil, who are listening to wrong, cannot suppress evil. How can Abu Bakr suppress truth? How can Abu Bakr suppress truth? Who seen Quran been revealed? So Abu Bakr started reading Quran loud again. So the kuffar came back to Ibn Daghina and they said, Inna ajarna Aba Bakrin bijiwari. We honored the security you extended to Abu Bakr on condition that he recites Quran secretly. So Ibn Daghina came to Abu Bakr and he said, don't make my matter difficult for me. I'm one side respecting you. Again, I have social pressure. I have domestic pressure. Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and I read this and Allah be my witness, I cry. I've read it repeatedly, but the iman, I find the statement brimming with iman. He said, فَإِنِّي أَرُدُّ إِلَيْكَ جِوَارَكَ وَأَرْضَى بِجِوَارِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَإِنِّي أَرُدُّ إِلَيْكَ جِوَارَكَ وَأَرْضَى بِجِوَارِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. I return to you your amnesty, I return to you your safety. The safety of my Allah is more than sufficient. May Allah favor us with the love of Quran. In the early part of the morning, Allah described the Sahaba. كَانُوا قَلِيلًا مِنَ اللَّيْلِ مَا يَهْجَعُونَ كَانُوا قَلِيلًا مِنَ اللَّيْلِ مَا يَهْجَعُونَ وَبِالْأَسْحَارِ هُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. They slept little by night. In the early part of the morning, they were reciting Quran. Umar ibn Khattab takes the reign of the Islamic Empire. We return back to the hadith. So someone tell Umar ibn Khattab that you are better than Abu Bakr. Now again, we learn great advice from these people. Somebody comes and praises us regarding our contemporaries, regarding our peers. How is our reaction? We'll say the next time, by say it louder. What did Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu say? He said, Wallahi la laylatum min Abi Bakr wa yawm khayrun min Umar wa Ali Umar. You said, I'm better than Abu Bakr. I swear by Allah, one night and one day of Abu Bakr is better than Umar and the Khattab progeny. Someone came and told him in Fadailu Sahaba, this riwayat comes, you are better than Abu Bakr. He said, لَقَدْ كَانَ أَبُو بَكْرٍ أَطْيَبَ مِنْ رِيحِ الْمِسْكِ وَأَنَا أَظَلُّ مِنْ بَعِيرِ أَهْلِي. Abu Bakr, he's better than musk. I'm worse than the camel of my house. And who was Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu? When he accepted Islam in Kanzul Ummal, in the 11th volume under the Manaqib of Umar radiallahu anhu, there is a riwayat, Jibreel Amin descended and he said, لَقَدْ اسْتَبْشَرَ بِهِ أَهْلُ السَّمَاءِ. O Nabi of Allah, never mind you people rejoicing, wallah, even the malaika are happy over the iman of Umar. On the night of Arafah, Nabi alayhi salam gathered the Sahaba and he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ بَاهَا بِالنَّاسِ عَشِيَّةَ عَرَفَ عَامَّةً وَبَاهَا بِعُمَرْ خَاصَّةً. Umar, I must tell you, last night Allah was fascinated with my Sahaba's performance. And Allah was boasting to the Sahaba, to the malaika about you people. But Umar, you were the highlight. You were the highlight of Arafah. If Allah boasted about anyone individually, it was you, O Umar. وَبَاهَا بِعُمَرْ خَاصَّةً. Can we imagine what was the privilege of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu? There is one riwayat, one day Nabi alayhi salam in Hayatul Sahaba, this riwayat comes. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam was sitting with Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu. Nabi alayhi salam said, Umar, what will be your condition when you will be lowered into the grave? And two angels will present before you, Munkar and Nakir. أَبْصَارُهُمَا كَالْبَرْقِ وَأَصْوَاتُهُمَا كَالْرَعْدِ. Their sight is like lightning, their voice is like thunder. They will have one stick in their hand. لَوِجْتَمَعَ عَلَيْهِ أَهْلُ مِنَا لَمْ يُتِيقُوا رَفْعَهَا. If all the people of Mina try to lift it, they won't able to carry the stick. But they will be shaking it like how I am shaking the stick of mine, so Umar. لَوْ ضَرَبَاكَ بِهَا ضَرْبَةً تَصِيرُ بِهَا رَمَادًا. Umar, if they hit you one, you will be reduced to ashes. Umar, what will be happen? What will happen to you when you will be lowered into your grave? He pondered, he said, O Nabi of Allah, will I be in my senses? Nabi alayhi salam said, yes, you'll be in your senses. He said, O Nabi of Allah, then I have confidence, very calmly I will handle the situation. Then in Hayatul Sahaba, there is another riwayat after this. وَزَادَ عَبْدُ الْوَاحِدْ فِي كِتَابِهِ التَّبْصِيرِ. Abdul Wahid makes mention in his Kitab al-Tafsir, Sayyidina Umar said this, the gathering ended, he took few steps, then Nabi alayhi salam called him and said, come back here Umar, listen to me. Jibreel descended now, and Jibreel told me, when you will be lowered into your grave, then the angels will come to you. And when the angels will come to you, you will tell the angels, Allahu Rabbi faman rabbukuma, wal Islamu deeni fama deenukuma, wa Muhammadun nabiyyi faman nabiyyukuma. I've given you the reference of this hadith. That you will tell the angels, Islam is my religion, what is your religion? By the way, Allah is my Lord. You want to tell me who's your Lord? And if you don't forget, Muhammad is my Prophet. You want to remind me who's yours? They will say, wa ajaba la nadri ursilna ilayka am anta ursilta ilayna. Really, we don't know, has Allah sent you to examine us or has Allah sent us to examine you? Yet that very Umar said, law nada munadin, innakum dakhilun al-jannah illa rajulan wahida la khiftu an akuna ana huwa. Wallahi, if an announcer announces from the heavens, everybody destined for Jannah but one exception, I'm afraid I'll be the exception. When he became the Amir, then he wrote to all the governors. What did he say? He said, la tarkubu birdawnan. This riwayat comes in Kitab al-Kharaj. La tarkubu birdawnan. ولا تلبسوا رقيقا ولا تأكلوا نقيا ولا تغلقوا أبوابكم دون حوائج الناس. You have been made entrusted. Listen, don't drive in exclusive or don't ride exclusive conveyances, which is نهي عن التكبر. Don't become proud and haughty. Don't wear fine clothes and don't eat excellent food, which is نهي عن التنعم. Don't become lavish in this world. And don't ever shut your door from the needs of this ummah. If you've ever done this, rest assured azab is on its way. وَكَانَ وَقَّافًا عِنْدَ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. The riwayat comes in Bukhari Sharif. Someone was sitting and someone said something to Umar radiallahu anhu. Blood gushed into his cheeks. Another sahabi came and he said, خُذِ الْعَفْوَ وَأَمُرْ بِالْعُرْفِ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِينَ. Umar overlook and ignore. That sahabi said, وَكَانَ وَقَّافًا عِنْدَ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. The sudden halt that Umar made, emotions building into him, anxiety, frustration, anger, everything coming to a point, he's about to vent it, and this sahabi read an ayat and it meant law. وَكَانَ وَقَّافًا عِنْدَ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. When Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu was in the throes of death, so much can be said regarding the life of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu. How can we condense it in few hours? Wallahi, it's the greatest injustice we've done. We haven't read the lives of these sahaba. There cannot be a greater injustice we have done that we haven't studied the lives of these people. When Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu was in the throes of death, he sent a message. He said, go and ask Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu anha if I can have the opportunity to be buried in the neighborhood of Nabi alayhi salam. The son Abdullah ibn Umar comes to Aisha radiallahu anha, presents the request to our respected mother. She says, this was my desire that I be buried next to Nabi alayhi salam. But Allah be my witness, Umar is that individual for whom all privileges can be given. Marhaban bi Amir al-Mu'mineen, marhaban bi Amir al-Mu'mineen. The riwayat of Bukhari, he is performing salah when Abu Lu'lu Majusi comes and strikes that spear and he falls and he becomes fatal. When he becomes conscious, he says, Hal sallal muslimun al-fajra. The fajr that was interrupted because of my illness, has that fajr namaz been completed or not? Has that fajr namaz been completed or not? What was the fear? What was the accountability? What was the vision? So after his death, just in the last moments, he tells his son, perhaps out of a mark of respect, my mother Aisha has consented. After my demise, go back to her house and don't say Amirul Mu'mineen is at the door. Say Umar ibn Khattab is at the door asking to be buried. If she accepts, privilege me by resting next to my Nabi. Otherwise, put me in Baqi where the general Muslims are sleeping. That was the vision of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu. He had such respect. He said, O Nabi of Allah, I want my father Khattab to accept Islam and you want your uncle Abbas. I swear by Allah, I'll be more happy the day Abbas accepts Islam because I know it will bring more joy to you. I will be more happy. He came to the Sahaba, he said, Zuffuni, Zuffuni, get me married, get me married. People said, to who? They said, Binti Ali, get me married to the daughter of Ali radiallahu anhu. Now you know the age gap between Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu and Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. And then the daughter of Sayyidina Ali, whose name was Umm Kulthum radiallahu anha. Finally the nikah was performed and he gave 40,000 dirhams as mahar. And then after that he went to the people and he said, Allah tuhanni'uni, won't you congratulate me? People said, why? They said that, he said, I got married to the daughter of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. And do you know what motivated me behind this marriage? Some food for thought for the young people that have gathered here. Sometimes we think there cannot be any other reason of getting married. What did Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu say? One hadith of Nabi alayhi salam, ينقطع كل سبب ونسب إلا سببي ونسبي. On the day of Qiyamah, all lineage and all relation will be severed. But anybody who is related to me, that will avail him in the spirit to become part of the family of Nabi alayhi salam. I got married to the granddaughter of Nabi alayhi salatu was salam, so that my bond with him remains intact even after my eyes close. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu leaves this dunya. This amanat comes onto Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. Sayyidina Uthman, like Hazrat Mawlana mentioned, Nabi alayhi salam said, لو كن عشرا لزوجتهن عثمان. If I had 10 daughters, I would have given it to Uthman radiallahu anhu. Allahu Akbar. One of the greatest virtue of Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu was on the occasion of Hudaybiyah, was on the occasion when the Sahaba were not allowed to, were not given access and were not given a safe passage into Makkah, and hence the pledge beneath the tree took place. لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ يُبَايَعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَةِ لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ يُبَايَعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَةِ فعلم ما في قلوبهم فأنزل السكينة عليهم وأثابهم فتحا قريبا. When Sayyidina Uthman went to negotiate, and then they told Sayyidina Uthman, listen, we will not give your Prophet access, nor the Muslims, you come next year. But you are here, make your Umrah and go. Sayyidina Uthman said, my Nabi cannot make Umrah and I must make Umrah impossible. Imagine this, the spirit. Wallah, for Sahaba, the sentiments of Nabi alayhi salam was ultimate. When Zayd ibn Su'na, the Yahudi rabbi, when he came, and then he just wanted to examine one quality of Nabi alayhi salam, يَسْبُقُ حِلْمُهُ جَهْلَهُ. That Nabi alayhi salam's tolerance surpasses his anger. And he was very arrogant to Nabi alayhi salam. وَعَيْنَاهُ تَدُورَانُ. The riwayat says, Umar radiallahu anhu's eyeballs started turning. And then Nabi alayhi salam had a chat, and Nabi alayhi salam said, you could be more polite. Nabi alayhi salam said, you should have, told Sayyidina Umar, Umar, you should have told him to be polite, and you should have told me to be prompt on my payments. So then Nabi alayhi salam said, Umar, you take him and give him whatever I owe him and give him extra because of your harshness. So as they are walking, Zayd ibn Su'na tells Umar, you know me? Umar says, in my humble words, the gist of that hadith, I don't know you and I don't want to know you. I don't know you and I doubt, how can you talk to my Nabi like that? I cry when I read this. Like, how can you trespass the limits of my Nabi? I don't know you and I don't want to know you. He said, Umar, listen to me, hear me out. You heard about Zayd ibn Su'na, the learned man? He said, yeah, I heard. Yeah, what? What about him? He says, you know what, I am that man. So he says, then you're so learned, why you talk like this? He said, I studied your Nabi, I was convinced he's the ultimate human. One quality was outstanding, I'm convinced he is the Nabi. Umar, I want to accept Islam. Here's all my wealth, give it in the path of Allah. So Sahaba, whenever anybody trespassed the limits of Nabi alayhi salam, the Quran said, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُنَادُونَكَ مِنْ وَرَاءِ الْحُجُرَاتِ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُنَادُونَكَ مِنْ وَرَاءِ الْحُجُرَاتِ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ. Those that were harsh to you, they don't have any sanity. وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ صَبَرُوا حَتَّى تَخْرُجَ إِلَيْهِمْ لَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُمْ. The etiquette of the discourses of Nabi alayhi salatu was salam. Uthman radiallahu anhu gets married to the daughter Ruqayya radiallahu anha. There is a riwayat in Sirat Anbiya that one day he says, after I got married to Ruqayya radiallahu anha, I was sitting by my aunt's house, Su'da, my maternal aunt. So she looked at me, and you know, couplets amongst them were unique. So I just got married to Nabi alayhi salam's daughter, newly wed. So she looked and she said, أَبْشِرْ وَحُيِّيْتَ ثَلَاثًا وِتْرًا ثم ثلاثا وثلاثا اخرى ثم باخرى لكي تتم عشرا لقيت خيرا ووقيت شرا نكحت والله حصانا زهرا وانت بكر ولقيت بكرا. I wish you can comprehend this in Arabic. She says, Uthman, I look at you like this. Abshir wa huyita thalatha witra. May you be congratulated three times. ثم ثلاثا وثلاثا اخرى. Make it another three and add another three and one more, make it 10 times. ثم بأخرى لكي تتم عشرا لقيت خيرا ووقيت شرا. Allah favored you with the greatest of privileges and Allah saved you from the greatest of harms. نكحت والله حصانا زهرا. نكحت والله حصانا زهرا. Allah gave you, what a chaste woman, what a beautiful woman, what a pious woman. Allah did not give it to anyone else. These two daughters were also in the nikah of Utbah and Utaybah. Listen to this, brothers. Ruqayya and Umm Kulthum radiyallahu anhuma, let me tie it up with those couplets. They were in the nikah of Abu Lahab, the daughters of, the sons of Abu Lahab. Then the verses were revealed. تَبَّتْ يَدَا أَبِي لَهَبٍ وَتَبْ مَا أَغْنَى عَنْهُ مَالُهُ وَمَا كَسَبْ. Where Allah condemned Abu Lahab and his wife Umm Jameel. She used to condemn Nabi alayhi salam. مُذَمَّمًا عَصَيْنَا أَمْرَهُ أَبَيْنَا دِينَهُ قَلَيْنَا. When these verses were revealed, Abu Lahab came to his two sons Utba and Utayba, and he said, رَأْسِي مِنْ رَأْسِكَ حَرَامٍ إِنْ لَمْ تُطَلِّقْ إِبْنَتَهُ. Listen, Muhammad's Quran, that is my nephew sallallahu alayhi wasallam, has condemned me. I will never speak to you, nay, I will disown you if you don't divorce his daughters. Both these sons then divorced the daughters of Nabi alayhi salam. Allah had a great vision. Allah had a great, great intention for Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu. And Allah then privileged him with this opportunity. One day Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu sent a plate of food at the house of Umm Salma. Nabi alayhi salam came home. Umm Salma said, your son-in-law Uthman radiallahu anhu has given this. Nabi alayhi salam lifted his hand and he said, Allahumma inna Uthmana yataraddaka fa ardi anhu. Oh Allah, my son-in-law Uthman is repeatedly trying to please you by impressing me. Allah, you be happy with him. Allah, you be happy with him. One day Nabi alayhi salam came and he seen Uthman was massaging the head. وَهِيَ تَغْسِلُ رَأْسَ زَيْنَبْ وَهِيَ تَغْسِلُ رَأْسَ أُمَّ كُلْثُومِ. She was busy washing and massaging the head of Umm Kulthum radiallahu anha. We walk into the house of our daughter and we see perhaps our daughter is serving our son-in-law. How do we respond? What is our duty? Nabi alayhi salam said, carry on doing this year, O my daughter. Carry on serving your husband. This is what will earn you Jannah. Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu, on the occasion of Badr, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam exempts him from participating in Badr. And then Nabi alayhi salam allots a share of the spoils of the war for Sayyidina Uthman. Sayyidina Ruqayya radiallahu anha passes away and Sayyidina Uthman is arraigned in the burial. They were just lowering her into the grave and a horseman advances. People lift their gaze and they said that the Muslims have been victorious at Badr. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam then comes back and then he comes to the grave of his daughter. He takes his beloved Fatima and she stands at the grave of her sister, and Nabi alayhi salam stands at the grave of his daughter Ruqayya radiallahu anha. His eyes become moist and he cries that I wasn't even present at the time when my daughter passes away. And then he cries and he says, Il haqi bi salafina Uthman ibn Mad'un. Go, O my daughter, go and join the ranks of Uthman ibn Mad'un. One few days after that he seen Sayyidina Uthman very sad, very depressed, very lonely. He said, Uthman, what is the matter? He said, O Nabi of Allah, I had the privilege of being your son-in-law. I had the honor of being married to your daughter. This privilege has been taken away. Nabi alayhi salam paused. And then after that, he said, Uthman, come. Jibreel has come to me. Allah has commanded I give my other daughter in your nikah. There is a riwayat, Nabi alayhi salam said, مَا تَزَوَّجْتُ شَيْئًا مِّن نِسَائِي وَلَا زَوَّجْتُ شَيْئًا مِّن بَنَاتِي إِلَّا بِوَحْيٍ جَاءَنِي بِهِ جِبْرِيلٍ. Never did I get married to any of my wives, nor did I get my son-in-laws married, but through divine approval from Allah. The greatest quality in the life of Uthman was Haya. Mawlana Shabir Sahib always speaks about this here, that if we have to analyze and we have to take out one, you know, we have major problems. But Mawlana always points out, if there's one thing to sum up all the challenges, it is that Haya has become absent. Haya has become absent. Ya ukhti la tarfa'i anki al-khimara fatandami suni jamalaki in arati karama. Oh my sister, live with modesty, live with haya. Allah praises, Allah praises. I don't want to digress and exceed my time limits. But let me tell you what is haya. I cannot resist the thoughts that flow through my mind at this juncture. Allah speaks about Sayyidatina Aisha radiallahu anha. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَرْمُونَ الْمُحْصَنَاتِ الْغَافِلَاتِ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ لُعِنُوا فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَرْمُونَ الْمُحْصَنَاتِ الْغَافِلَاتِ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ لُعِنُوا. Now if you study this verse, the word ghafilat has come in the context of praise. Ghafilat, those that are unmindful, those that are deliberately unmindful, but here it has come in praise. Unmindful of the cosmetic world, unmindful of what is happening in that dunya. Deliberately, and Allah uses this in the praise of madah. You know, Imam Qurtubi speaks about Aisha radiallahu anha, Allahu Akbar, that Sayyidina Yusuf was accused with zina. Sayyidina Maryam alayhi salam was accused with zina. And Sayyidatina Aisha radiallahu anha was also accused with zina. But Imam Qurtubi rahmatullah alayhi says, إِنَّ يُوسُفَ لَمَّا رُمِيَ بِالْفَاحِشَ بَرَّأَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَى لِسَانِ صَبِيٍّ فِي الْمَهْدِ وَإِنَّ مَرْيَمَ لَمَّا رُمِيَتْ بِالْفَاحِشَ بَرَّأَهَا اللَّهُ عَلَى لِسَانِ ابْنِهَا وَإِنَّ عَيْشَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا لَمَّا رُمِيَتْ بِالْفَاحِشَ فَمَا رَضِيَ لَهَا بِبَرَاءَةِ صَبِيٍّ وَلَا نَبِيٍّ فَمَا رَضِيَ لَهَا بِبَرَاءَةِ صَبِيٍّ وَلَا نَبِيٍّ. That Sayyidina Yusuf was also accused with zina. Oh my mother, it's time. Oh my sister, it's time you get your focus correct. It's time you stop making these women the ideals of your life. It's time you make the wives of Nabi alayhi salam a point of reference. It's time you relate to them. He says, when Sayyidina Yusuf was accused with zina, Allah made a child speak, وَشَهِدَ شَاهِدٌ مِّنْ أَهْلِهَا إِنْ كَانَ قَمِيصُهُ قُدَّ مِّنْ قُبُلٍ. When Sayyidina Maryam was accused, Allah made Isa speak. But when our mother was accused, Allah wasn't happy for a child to speak. Nay, Allah wasn't happy for Nabi alayhi salam to speak. Allah revealed Quran. I wish you could comprehend Arabic. Your hearts will burst if you understand. Mufassirin have written, this is one of the only verses where Allah has come across so strongly. إِذْ تَلَقَّوْنَهُ بِأَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَتَقُولُونَ بِأَفْوَاهِكُمْ مَا لَيْسَ لَكُمْ بِهِ عِلْمٌ وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. When you were circulating a slander and you were blurting something regarding which you know nothing and you trivialized the crime, whereas in the eyes of Allah there could not be a more major crime. That was the honor that Allah gave to Siddiqa, Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu anha. Her relation, her closeness to Nabi alayhi salam, I don't have time, if I explore I will run into hours. Nonetheless, Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu, he is favored with the second daughter of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. And at the time when he was assassinated, Nabi alayhi salam had told him that Allah will give you a privilege. The munafiq will try and take this out of you, but remain firm and meet me at my pond in Jannat. Remain firm and meet me at my pond in Jannat. And he remained firm, and he remained firm. And hence in Kanzul Ummal there is one riwayat. Nabi alayhi salam says, I was sitting, Jibreel came in the 11th volume, and Jibreel took me into the garden of my Allah. If جُعِلَتْ تُفَّاحَةٌ فِي يَدِي, one apple was put in my hand, فَانْفَلَتَتِ التُفَّاحَةُ نِسْفَيْنِ, the apple split in two, خَرَجَتْ مِنْهَا جَارِيَةٌ, one woman came out of this apple, لَمْ أَرَى أَحْسَنَ مِنْهَا حُسْنًا وَلَا أَجْمَلَ مِنْهَا جَمَالًا تُسَبِّحُ تَسْبِيحًا, I have never seen a woman of greater beauty who was praising Allah. I asked her, who are you? And for whom has Allah created you? She said, أَنَا مِنَ الْحُورِ الْعِينِ خَلَقَنِيَ اللَّهُ مِن نُورِ عَرْشِهِ, I am from that hur that Allah has created from the light of His throne. Then Nabi alayhi salam said, for who are you? She said, أَنَا لِلْخَلِيفَةِ الْمَظْلُومِ عُثْمَانِ ابْنَ عَفَّانِ, Allah has created me for the oppressed Khalifa Uthman ibn Affan. Brothers, may Allah favor me, Allah favor you with modesty, with haya, with shame, with bashfulness. Really it is mafqood. Haya is something that we lack totally. Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, the knowledge Allah had given him was unique, was outstanding. Under the commentary of this verse in the Quran, where Allah speaks about the number of the people of Kahf, لا يعلمهم إلا قليل, لا يعلمهم إلا قليل. There's difference of opinion, how many members were there who slept in the cave? Some say this, some say that. And then Allah concludes with regards that they were seven. And Allah says only few people knew their exact amount. Only few people. Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu said, أنا من القليل, I am amongst those few people. You know what knowledge it takes, brothers. There's not a claim. It's not like us, you know, I know, we all know today. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يُجَادِلُ فِي اللَّهِ بِغَيْرِ عَلْمٍ وَلَا هُدًى وَلَا كِتَابٍ مُنِيرٍ. There are many people who chant slogans but know nothing. So he says, أَنَا مِنَ الْقَلِيلِ, I am amongst those few people. Let me run you through some couplets of Sayyidina Ali, which is also advice. I show you, you know, the knowledge Allah had given him. He used to say, النَّاسُ مِنْ جِهَةِ التَّمْثِيلِ أَكْفَاءُ أَبُوهُمْ آدَمُ وَالْأُمُّ حَوَّاءُ نَفْسٌ كَنَفْسٍ وَأَرْوَاحٌ مُشَاكِلَةٌ وَأَعْظَمٌ خُلِقَتْ فِيهَا وَأَعْضَاءُ فَإِنْ يَكُنْ لَهُمْ مِنْ أَصْلِهِمْ حَسَبٌ يُفَاخِرُونَ بِهِ فَالطِّينُ وَالْمَاءُ مَا الْفَضْلُ إِلَّا لِأَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ إِنَّهُمْ عَلَى الْهُدَى لِمَنِ اسْتَهْدَى أَدِلَّاءُ. This is only half of the couplets. Nonetheless, he says, if there's virtue and merit that can go to any individual, it is the ulama. It is those that possess the knowledge of deen. And you know what knowledge Allah gave him? One day one person came to him and asked him, Ali radiallahu anhu, tell us what is the difference between qareeb and aqrab, between wajib and awjab, between sab and as'ab? You tell me what is the difference between all these words. Now there's a bit of Arabic grammar, but nonetheless I will simplify it for you. Farz means compulsory, wajib means mandatory, awjab something of greater importance, ismet tafzil. And then qareeb means close, aqrab means extremely close, sab means difficult, as'ab means extremely difficult. So he asked Sayyidina Ali, you tell me the difference. Sayyidina Ali says, you want to listen to it one time? He says, yes, please tell me. He says, okay, listen. فَرْضٌ عَلَى النَّاسِ أَن يَتُوبُوا لَكِنَّ تَرْكَ الذُّنُوبِ أَوْجَبُ. والدهر في صرفه عجيب، وغفلة الناس فيه أعجب، والصبر في النائبات صعب، لكن فوت الثواب أصعب، وكل ما يرتجى قريب، والموت من كل ذاك أقرب. You have to appreciate this in Arabic, brothers. How can I translate this? I don't have the words. He gave everything in those few couplets. فَرْضٌ عَلَى النَّاسِ أَنْ يَتُوبُ. It is compulsory for every man to repent. لَكِنَّ تَرْكَ الذُّنُوبِ أَوْجَبُ. But to forsake and abandon sins, that is of vital importance. Then he says, وَالدَّهْرُ فِي صَرْفِهِ عَجِيبٌ. The time, the error in its deception, in its attitude is rather strange. وَغَفْلَةُ النَّاسِ فِيهِ أَعْجَبٌ. But the oblivious, heedless attitude of humanity is more astonishing, is more startling, is more perplexing. وَالصَّبْرُ فِي النَّائِبَاتِ صَعْبٌ. Patience in adversity is rather difficult. لَكِنَّ فَوْتَ الثَّوَابِ أَصْعَبٌ. But not to endure patience and forfeit the reward is more difficult. وَكُلُّ مَا يُرْتَجَى قَرِيبٌ. Everything being anticipated is rather close. وَالْمَوْتُ مِنْ كُلِّ ذَاكَ أَقْرَبٌ. And out of all the things that are being anticipated, the closest of all is death. One day Sayyidina Jabir radiallahu anhu came to Ali radiallahu anhu. So Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu said, these are advisors and this is what I'm sharing. While I say the virtues coupled with that are the advisors. This is how we've got to bring. One of the tragedies of our times is we are measuring our piety with people whom Allah has not made the basis of comparison, and we wrongly console ourselves that we are pious. So I compare my wife to my neighbor's wife, and I say, she doesn't put a scarf. My wife, at least the scarf is still dangling on her shoulders. So my wife is better. My son is better than my brother's son because he still comes from Maghrib. My brother's son, I barely see him for Jummah. So my son is better than my brother's son. I'm better than my neighbor because Alhamdulillah, at least sometimes I read Quran. That person, I've never ever heard reading Quran from him. We are fooling ourselves. Allah, we've fallen into a comfort zone. Allah will not match your Aisha with your brother's Aisha. Allah will match your Aisha with Nabi alayhi salam's Aisha. فَإِنْ آمَنُوا بِمِثْلِ مَا آمَنْتُمْ بِهِ فَقَدْ اِهْتَدَوْا. فَإِنْ آمَنُوا بِمِثْلِ مَا آمَنْتُمْ بِهِ فَقَدْ اِهْتَدَوْا. The yardstick to which Allah will measure you will be the Sahaba. Match your Ali with the Ali of Nabi alayhi salam. Match your Abu Bakr with the Abu Bakr of Nabi alayhi salam. If they are on par, they enjoy the same privilege. Otherwise, you have deceived yourself, my brother. You have deceived yourself. And unfortunately, this is the general condition. So Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu is sitting with Jabir radiallahu anhu. Brothers, forgive me, I'm going to end inshallah. Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu is sitting with Jabir radiallahu anhu. He says, Jabir, qiwamud dunya bi arba'a. This dunya's existence depends on four people. Alimun, of knowledge, a scholar who practices on his knowledge and conveys his knowledge. A scholar who has knowledge, practices on it and conveys it. Number two, jahilun la yastankifu an yata'allam. A person who is ignorant but does not find it below his dignity to learn. I share an incident with you. One day one brother invited me one place for a lecture. When I got there after the program was over, he said, Maulana, I want to read Quran. An elderly person in his 60s. So he started reading Quran. Then he started crying profusely. So I asked him, what's the matter? He showed me a racing course. He says, Maulana, you see that place? Allah forgive me, that is where I spend my life. And my children have rebelled against me. And I know why they have rebelled me, because I have nourished them with haram. I'm only hoping that the systems flush out the haram I have put in them. He says, one day I went in there and I heard the Maghrib Azan and there was clash of emotions. And he's tearing while he's telling me this. In our country, I went there and then he's narrating this to me. And after that, I thought to myself, how long will I carry on like this? So I heard the Azan and I said, let me respond to it. Abdullah ibn Abbas said, لَوْ يَعْلَمُ النَّاسُ مَا يَقُولُ الْمُؤَذِّنُ مَسْتَرَاحُ وَلَا نَامُ. If people understood what this muazzin is saying, never mind sleep, even slumber won't overpower them. I came to the masjid, I cried to Allah, I repented to Allah. After that, I held the Quran and I cried. I said, Ya Allah, I learned everything, but I don't know Quran. I went to the local imam of the masjid and I said, you know what, I need to learn Quran. So he said, no problem, a very high profile businessman, and that is why I share it with you. He said, no problem, but I don't have extra time. If you can come in my regular afternoon times wherein I teach the children, then by all means you can come. He said, no, I have no problem to come. It is my need. I don't know the Quran. He's in his 60s. He said, I will sit with the young, small siblings and I will learn Quran. He says, Alhamdulillah, 2 years have passed. My shop closes at 2:30 and I go to madrasa with my Quran. And Alhamdulillah, today I can read Quran. Then after reading Quran, he cried and he said, Mawlana, will the day come before I die that I understand what I read? I said, whether the day comes or not, Allah will give you that reward in relation to your passion. Jahilun la yastankifu an yata'allam. Who does not find it below his dignity to learn deen. Number three, jawadun, a wealthy man, but who, saqiyun, a wealthy man, but who spends in the deen of Allah. And number four, faqirun la yabi'u deenahu. A poor person who does not forsake his deen. Then he said, O Jabir, if Allah has given wealth to any man, rest assured, the creation of Allah will come to him. If he will respond positively and discharge the obligation of the wealth that Allah has given him, then that wealth will prosper. But if he will hoard that wealth, then soon it will disappear. Then he said, Jabir, why don't I put it in couplets for you and listen to what I have to say. He said, Ma ahsana ad-dunya wa iqbalaha, idha ata'a Allah manna laha. Ma ahsana ad-dunya wa iqbalaha, idha ata'a Allah manna laha. من لم يواس الناس من فضله عرض للإدبار إقبالها فاحذر زوال الفضل يا جابر وأعط من دنياك من سألها فإن ذا العرش جزيل العطاء يضعف بالحبة أمثالها وكم رأينا من ذوي ثروة لم يقبلوا بالشكر إقبالها تاهوا على الدنيا بأموالهم وقيدوا بالبخل أطفالها لو شكروا النعمة جازاهم مقالة الشكر التي قالها لئن شكرتم لأزيدنكم لكنما كفرهم غالها. Again, brothers, how can I translate these things? We haven't touched it, and there are kitabs written on the couplets of Ali. Not one, two, kitabs written. He said, how beautiful this dunya is if the one who has it knows how to use it. ما أحسن الدنيا وإقبالها إذا أطاع الله منا لها. The one who has it fears Allah. من لم يواس الناس من فضله عرض للإدبار إقبالها. The one that does not discharge in relation to what Allah has given him, then very soon that wealth will perish. That very wealth that is coming will disappear from him. Then he said, فاحذر زوال الفضل يا جابر. O Jabir, you should... The one that does not discharge in relation to what Allah has given him, then very soon that wealth will perish. That very wealth that is coming will disappear from him. Then he said, فَاحْذَرْ زَوَالَ الْفَضْلِ يَا جَابِرِ. O Jabir, you should fear that your surplus wealth be snatched from you. Maulana Saad Sahib Damat Barakatum one day mentioned, the greatest tragedy of this ummah today is, it considers its leisure time and its surplus wealth as a personal commodity. The greatest tragedy of this ummah is my time, my money. When Nabi alayhi salam said, spend, فَإِنَّ ذَا الْعَرْشِ جَزِيلُ الْعَطَى يُذَقِّفُ بِالْحَبَّةِ أَمْثَالَهَا. You know how Allah gives? Nabi alayhi salam said, Allah is exhorting you to give. Abu Dahdar radiallahu anhu came and said, Ya Rasulallah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَسْتَقْرِضُنَا وَهُوَ غَنِيٌّ عَنِ الْقَرْضِ. Does Allah want a loan from us? Nabi alayhi salam says, Naam yuridu an yudkhilakum al-jannah. Allah wants a loan to give you an opportunity to get into Jannah. He says, okay, I have two gardens. Ihdahuma bis-safila wal ukhra bil-aliya. Ja'altuhuma lillah. I have two gardens, take it for Allah. One has 600 date palms in it. Now brothers, if we need to give 500 also, with respect to my sisters downstairs, we got to consult. We got to get approval. We got to get confirmation. So he says, O Nabi of Allah, take it. Nabi alayhi salam says, give me one and the other one you keep it. His wife and his children were sitting in the garden, they were reclining. He comes there and from outside he screams and he says, أَقْرَضْتُهُ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ اَعْتِمَادِ بِالطَّوْعِ لَا مَنَّا وَالْأَرْتِدَادِ إِلَّا رَجَاءَ الضِّعْفِ فِي الْيَمْعَادِ فَارْتَحِلِي بِالنَّفْسِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ وَالْبِرُّ لَا شَكَّ فَخَيْرُ زَادٍ قَدَّمَهُ الْمَرْءُ إِلَى الْمَعَادِ. He tells his wife, listen, I can't come inside, now it belongs to Allah. Come out. She also was one ahead. She said, بَشَّرَكَ اللَّهُ بِخَيْرٍ وَفَرَجٍ مِثْلُكَ أَدَّى لَدَيْهِ مِثْلُكَ أَدَّى مَا لَدَيْهِ وَنَصَحَ قَدْ مَتَّعَ اللَّهُ بِهِ عِيَالِي وَمَنَحَ بِالْعَجْوَةِ السَّوْدَاءِ وَالزَّهْوِ الْبَلَحِ. He tells her, come out. And then she starts walking out. Nabi alayhi salam observing. Then she takes out the dates from the pockets of the children. She takes out the dates from the sleeves of the children. She says, now it belongs to Allah. The wife, husband and children are dusting every date because now my husband gave it to Allah. Nabi alayhi salam looked at this, he cried, and then he said one thing, كَمْ مِنْ عِذْطٍ رَدَاحٍ وَدَارٍ فَيَّاحٍ لِأَبِدْ دَحْدَى. Allah alone knows what homes this family will have in Jannat. Allah alone knows what homes this family will have in Jannah. Brothers, I can say much more. I'm running out of time. Wallah, these are Sahaba. You know, the Quran speaks about the Sahaba of Musa alayhi salam. When they accepted Islam and they gave their lives, Ibn Kathir explains it very beautifully, those magicians. And then they started giving da'wah. They started giving da'wah because of the company of Musa alayhi salam. Instantly they gave da'wah. إِنَّهُ مَنْ يَأْتِ رَبَّهُ مُجْرِمًا فَإِنَّ لَهُ جَهَنَّمْ لَا يَمُوتُ فِيهَا وَلَا يَحْيَا وَمَنْ يَأْتِهِ مُؤْمِنًا قَدْ عَمِلَ الصَّالِحَاتِ فَأُولَئِكَ لَهُمُ الدَّرَجَاتُ الْعُلَى. That the one who will die is a criminal, he will suffer by Allah, and the one who obeys Allah, for him are the high abodes. They just brought iman and they gave this da'wah here. As Hazrat Muhammad Shabir Sahib mentioned the hadith of Bukhari, it comes in first volume on page 394. Abu Zar radiallahu anhu, but Abu Zar, another sahabi, makes mention of it, that one person came to Nabi alayhi salatu was salam, and he said, O Nabi of Allah, Uslim aw uqatil. Must I bring Islam or must I fight? I see you people are going in battle. What must I do? Nabi alayhi salam said, Aslim thumma qatil. Why don't you do this? Accept Islam and then fight. So do both. Fa aslama fa qatala fa qutila. So he accepted Islam. He joined Nabi alayhi salam, went into the battle, was martyred. Nabi alayhi salam said, amila qaleel wa ujra kathir. He did little and got lots. Amila qaleel wa ujra kathir. Sahaba, the riwayat comes in Bukhari, second volume. They say, kunna na'budu hajaran. فَإِذَا وَجَدْنَا حَجَرًا خَيْرًا مِّنْهُ أَلْقَيْنَاهُ وَأَخَذْنَا الْآخَرِ غَالِبًا is the call of one tabi'i. That we used to worship a stone. And this is solace for every person here. That don't look at your past, the vision is open. Allah's kindness is there. When you look at what the Sahaba did in the past, one could never imagine that they would climb to such heights and they would reach such status. They say we used to worship a stone. The next day if we found another stone that had a better sparkle, we would forsake the first god and embrace the second one. So there's a riwayat, we all know about Amr ibn Jamuh radiallahu anhu, who was crippled. His son Mu'adh radiallahu anhu accepted Islam. So he came to his father and he said, oh my father, you should accept Islam. So the father did not accept Islam. So one day he got ready with his other companion Mu'adh ibn Jabal. In Sirat al-Mustafa, it's mentioned in great detail and reference of Bidayah is given. So anyway, he took the god of his father and he dumped it somewhere. Next morning the father got up looking for his god. Where's my god? Where's my god? He couldn't find his god. Finally found his god, cleaned it, brought it back, and he put it there. Again the next day, Mu'adh radiallahu anhu, Mu'adh ibn Amr ibn Jamuh radiallahu anhu, took that god, he threw it somewhere. The father, the next morning, got up, searched for his god, found it. He decided, today what I'm going to do, I'm going to put an X around this god. If he is strong, he must fight. If he's strong, he must fight. Otherwise, he's hopeless. So what they did was, the next morning, they took the X away. You know, in the Hashya of Jalalain, there's something very beautiful written. فَإِنَّ مَنْ لَا يَدْفَعُ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ الْفَأْسَ كَيْفَ يَدْفَعُ عَنْ عَابِدِهِ الْبَأْسَ. That object which cannot move an axe from its head, how can it move calamity from its worshipper? فَإِنَّ مَنْ لَا يَدْفَعُ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ الْفَأْسَ كَيْفَ يَدْفَعُ عَنْ عَابِدِهِ الْبَأْسَ. Anyway, he took the idol, he tied it to a dog and he dropped it in a well. Now this is the kamal of the Sahaba of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Till today he worshipped it, he honored it, he revered it. The next morning when he got up looking for his god and he found the god was lying in the well, he looked at it, he paused, and then iman flowed from him. Iman flowed from him. He said, Wallahi law kunta ilahan. Wallahi law kunta ilahan. He praised Allah at this juncture in a manner that you and I till today cannot praise Allah. And this was the sohbet of Nabi alayhi salam. Wallahi law kunta ilahan lam takun anta wa kalbun wasta bi'rin fi qaran. أُفِّلْ لَمْ إِلْقَاكَ إِلَهًا مُسْتَدًا الْآنَ فَتَّشْنَاكَ عَنْ سُوءِ الْغَبَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الْعَلِيِّ ذِي الْمِنَنِ الْوَاهِبِ الرَّزَّاقِ دَيَّانِ الدِّينِ هُوَ الَّذِي أَنْقَذَنِي مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ أَكُونَ فِي ظُلْمَةِ قَبْرٍ مُرْتَهَنْ بِأَحْمَدَ الْمَهْدِيِّ النَّبِيِّ الْمُؤْتَمَنِ أَتُوبُ إِلَى اللَّهِ مِمَّا مَضَى وَأَسْتَنْقِذُ اللَّهَ مِنْ نَارِهِ وَأُثْنِي عَلَيْهِ بِنِعْمَائِهِ إِلَهَ الْحَرَامِ وَأَسْتَارِهِ فسبحانه عدد الخاطئين وقطر السماء ومدراره هداني وقد كنت في ظلمة هداني وقد كنت في ظلمة حليف منات وأحجاره وأنقذني بعد شيب القذال من شين ذاك ومن عاره فقد كدت أهلك في ظلمة تدارك ذاك بمقداره فحمدا وشكرا له ما بقيت إله الأنام وجباره أريد بذلك إذ قلته مجاورة الله في داره. He praised Allah, brothers, in such a way that till today, if we gather all our praises, it cannot be a gist of what he said. He said, if you were a God, you wouldn't have been humiliated in this well. Today, my Allah has opened my eyes. Oh Allah, may shower and may you be praised and glorified, equivalent to my sins and the sinners and the sins of the sinners throughout the world. Look at how he praises Allah. May glory be to Allah. فَسُبْحَانَهُ عَدَدَ الْخَاطِئِينَ وَقَطْرِ السَّمَاءِ هَدَانِي وَقُدْ كُنْتُ فِي ظُلْمَةٍ. Allah guided me, I was in darkness. خَلِيفَ مَنَاتٍ وَأَحْجَارِ. Sometimes I was worshipping manat, sometimes I worshipped another stone. Allah guided me after my beard became white. Allah guided me, otherwise I was to be lowered into the darkness of my grave. I say this, and I will say it as long as I live, hoping that I can get shade under his throne the day I die. Brothers, Sahaba gave their lives. مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ رِجَالٌ صَدَقُوا مَا عَاهَدُوا اللَّهَ عَلَيْهِ فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَضَى نَحْبَهُ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَظِرْ. Mullah Ahmed Latsab said, in the Sahaba there were only two groups. Under this ayat he said there were only two groups. Those that were martyred and those that were waiting for martyrdom. There was no other group among Sahaba. There was no Khubayb radiallahu anhu. Some food for thought for the young that have gathered here. Today Allah has made it so easy. When he was about to be executed, he said, permit me to read two rakat namaz. Today Allah forgive, before an interview we cannot read two rakat namaz. Imagine at this juncture that he is about to be executed. أول من سن الركعتين عند القتل خبيب. He performs two rakat namaz. How calmly he performs it. Then he ends that namaz. He said, لولا أن تظنوا أني إنما طولت جزعا من الموت لاستكثرت من الصلاة. If it wasn't for the fear that you will interpret me prolonging my namaz out of the fear of the sword, I would have gone on reading namaz. But I don't want you to get the misinterpretation, the misunderstanding that he's afraid of death. So that's why I cut my namaz short, otherwise I was enjoying my Allah. Nabi alayhi salam spoke to the Sahaba about Dajjal, that he will come one day, will last for 1 year. Sahaba asked, O Nabi of Allah, that one day that will last like 1 year, must we perform five namaz or namaz equivalent to 1 year? Look at their mind. How our mind, you know, anybody talks of anything, we deduce money out of it. You know, he's asking a mustache, how our mind is operating, we can make, you know, mind is running somewhere else. Mind is running somewhere else all the time. 1 3-year-old child, I seen him, mashallah, making dua. So the brother went to him, he said, what dua are you making? He said, wait man, I'm asking Allah to give daddy more money. Alhamdulillah, it's good. But is that the only thing we ask Allah? Is that the only thing that we ask Allah? This dunya has its temptations, it has its challenges also. What dua Nabi alayhi salam made for his children? Allahumma ja'al rizqa ala Muhammadin quta. Allah, my family, give them only so much that it keeps them alive. Allah, give them so much that they are alive. Khubayb radiallahu anhu ends his two rakat namaz. Allahu Akbar. A young man in the prime of his life, on the call of the deen of Allah. He looks at them, no, brothers, if I give you time and I give myself time till the next jalsa and I say you make some couplets, till the next year we won't prepay. You know how calm you have to be, how much ease you have to be for your mind to flow, to say something. Yeah, he's about to be executed. A person today is just waiting for results that will determine if he's got cancer or not. And then you see the anxiety in that waiting room. The anxiety grips him because that results are determined, they are decisive. If it means that he's got red cells or this cells, then it means a different life. His whole destiny is changed. Here they are about to execute him. He says, لَقَدْ جَمَّعَ الْأَحْزَابُ حَوْلِي وَأَلَّبُوا قَبَائِلَهُمْ وَاسْتَجْمَعُوا كُلَّ مَجْمَعِي. They have gathered around me. They have exhorted others. They have gathered everyone here. فَقَدْ جَمَّعُوا أَبَنَاءَهُمْ وَنِسَاءَهُمْ وَقُرِّبْتُ مِنْ جِذْعٍ طَوِيلٍ مُمَنَّعِي. فَقَدْ جَمَّعُوا أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَنِسَاءَهُمْ وَقُرِّبْتُ مِنْ جِذْعٍ طَوِيلٍ مُمَنَّعِي إِلَى اللَّهِ أَشْكُو غُرْبَتِي ثُمَّ كُرْبَتِي وَمَا أَرْصَدَ الْأَحْزَابُ لِي عِنْدَ مَسْرَعِي فَذَا الْعَرْشُ صَبِّرْنِي عَلَى مَا يُرَادُ بِي فَقَدْ بَضَّعُوا لَحْمِي وَقَدْ بَانَ مَطْعَمِي. He said, Allah, they have gathered everyone. For them it's joy, for them it's excitement. For me it's my last moments. Allah, they are about to slaughter me. فَلَسْتُ أُبَالِي. These couplets come in Bukhari also. فَلَسْتُ أُبَالِي حِينَ أُقْتَلُ مُسْلِمًا. Allah, you know I have no problem as long as I'm beheaded for your deen. عَلَىٰ أَيِّ جَمْبٍ كَانَ لِلَّهِ مَدْجَعِي. He faced Qibla, they turned him away. He said, Allah, as long as I die for you, regardless of the direction they turn me, I am happy. Then he said, وَقَدْ خَيَّرُونِ الْكُفْرَ وَالْمَوْتَ دُونَهُ وَقَدْ هَمَلَتْ عَيْنَايَ مِنْ غَيْرِ مَجْزَعِي وَمَا بِي حِذَارُ الْمَوْتِ إِنِّي لَمَيِّتُ وَلَكِنْ حِذَارِي جَحْمُ نَارٍ مُلَفَّعِي فلست بمبد للعدو تخشعا ولا جزعا إني إلى الله مرجعي. They telling me either become a kafir or then accept death, as if kufr is an option for me. Allahu Akbar. They telling me either become a kafir or then accept death, as if kufr is an option for me. وَقَدْ خَيَّرُونِ الْكُفْرَ وَالْمَوْتَ دُونَهُ وَقَدْ هَمَلَتْ عَيْنَايَ مِنْ غَيْرِ مَجْزَعِي. My eyes have become moist, Allah knows, not out of the fear of the sword. وَمَا بِي حِذَارُ الْمَوْتِ إِنِّي لَمَيِّتُ. Never am I afraid to die. وَلَكِنْ حِذَارُ جَحْمُ نَارٍ مُلَفَّعِي. Yes, I am afraid about the subsequent stages after death. فَلَسْتُ بِمُبْدٍ لِلْعَدُوِّ تَخَشُّعًا وَلَا جَزَعًا. I will never succumb to the pressure of these people and humiliate myself. Saying this, he said, "Inni ilallahi marji'i." I am on my way to my Allah. And he took his last breath and he went away. Brothers, it is time we reflect. I have been speaking about this in the last many programs. Hadith of Nabi alayhi salam, "Kama ta'ishuna tamutun." The manner in which you live, that is how you will die. Rest assured, your daily routine and your last day will be no different. If your every day you get up after the sun has risen, I'm afraid the day you die, you will also miss Fajr that day. If your daily practice is then to go in the shower and shave your beard, I'm afraid the day you will be lowered in your qabr, you'll put a blade on the sunnah of your Nabi that very day. There will be no difference to your routine. Your life, just as you live every day, that is how it will be your last day. It's high time we change our everyday life. So if it coincides with our last day, it is a manner in which we are ready to meet Allah. Someone came and told Nabi alayhi salam, "Inna ammaran qad kafar." In Madarik al-Tanzeel, this comes under the commentary of this verse. Illa man ukriha wa qalbuhu mutma'innun bil iman. So someone threatened Ammar radiallahu anhu, so he uttered the word of kufr. So they came running to Nabi alayhi salam, "Your sahabi Ammar has become a kafir." In Madarik al-Tanzeel it is written, Nabi alayhi salam said, "Kalla, inna ammaran muli'a imanan." Ammar, I refute what you say. Ammar's whole body is filled with iman. وَاخْتَلَطَ الْإِيمَانُ بِلَحْمِهِ وَدَمِهِ. You might have blood in your body, Nabi alayhi salam says, Ammar has blood, he has iman flowing in his body. So this was the vision, this was the condition, this is what the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said regarding Sahaba Ikram Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. May Allah grant them a befitting reward on our behalf. May Allah elevate their abodes in Jannah. May Allah give us the tawfiq that we emulate them, we imitate them. Brothers, when we travel in the Middle East, wherever we go, let us visit the graves of Sahaba. Let us visit the graves. Where today we take our children, leave sometimes the Paris and leave the New York, leave the Malaysia and the Dubai, take them to the graves of these great people, stand by the graves of Sahaba and understand who they were. Let me leave you with my last couplet. حَلَفَ الزَّمَانُ لَيَأْتِيَنَّ بِمِثْلِهِمْ حَنَثَتْ يَمِينُكَ يَا زَمَانُ فَكَفِّرْ. حَلَفَ الزَّمَانُ لَيَأْتِيَنَّ بِمِثْلِهِمْ حَنَثَتْ يَمِينُكَ يَا زَمَانُ فَكَفِّرْ. The time the error claimed that it could produce the likes of Sahaba, I think there's consensus that it has failed miserably. It's high time they give kafara. Never will this world, nor the sun, nor the moon ever see the likes of Abu Bakr, see the likes of Sahaba. One day Abu Darda walked ahead of Abu Bakr. Nabi alayhi salam said, "Tamshi amama man huwa khayrun minka fi dunya wal akhirah." Abu Darda, the riwayat comes in Kanzul Ummal. Abu Darda, you take the courage to walk ahead of a human who is better than you in this world and the akhirah. وَاللَّهِ مَا طَلَعَتِ الشَّمْسُ وَلَا غَرَبَتْ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ بَعْدَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالْمُرْسَلِينَ أَفْضَلْ مِنْ أَبِي بَكْرِ. I swear by Allah, never has the sun risen nor set on any individual after the galaxy of Anbiya more noble than Abu Bakr. May Allah resurrect us amongst the galaxy of Anbiya and Sahaba, that we also enjoy the privilege of their closeness on the day of Qiyamah. وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.